Hello, everybody. And yeah, welcome to another episode of Inside XRF. I'll be your host for the next 30 minutes. My name is Konstantin Brenkens, and the topic of today's webinar will be method development correction models for calibration. So let's go right into it. As always, if there are any questions, feel free to just type them in the question and answer window. If we find some time in the end of this presentation, we will pick a few questions. If not, we'll get back to you by emails and the usual ways of communication. Okay, so let's have a look. Should be all good to go. There we go. This is just an overview of the topics that were covered and will be covered by our little mini series. So if you remember, the last webinar was about the, well, mostly the measurement side of a calibration. Today's topic will be these highlighted things: creating components, creating measurement and calibration samples, line overlap, and mainly calibration. And then the next two will cover drift correction measurements and validation. So those are at the later date. We'll start with our presentation today. So when it comes to calibrations, the first thing that we want to think about is there is a lot of different materials out there, and all of them may require a different strategy. So we have a few examples here. And obviously, when you are measuring these different samples, your target is a different one. So for a cement, you would want to know the oxide composition of your materials or your raw materials, while in a mineral oil, for example, you're looking for impurities and maybe wear metals. So when it comes to calibration and correction, the first thing that you want to do is you want to create your components. And what's important here is to understand how we get a result out of the X-ray later. The X-ray machine basically is just counting atoms, and we are using the elemental lines, or often in the software they are called channels, to do that for us. And with our calibration, we connect those count rates from the channels, or the number of atoms, to an element or oxide form. So we count something and transfer it into a concentration, for example, and the components help us to give us the right component. For example, as I said, in an ore sample or a mineralic sample, we would be looking, for example, for aluminum oxide, while in a metal alloy, we would be looking for aluminum as an element. On the XRF side, this is all just basically counting aluminum atoms. And for the applications, for the calibrations, we often use standards, and we have to make sure that all of the standards that we are going to use, that they present the analyte in the same form. So there is an example of a Fluxana CRM here. And as you can see, the parameter here, or the component, is quite clear. It says here alumina oxide, it's 8% or 8.06. So if we wanted to use this for whatever reason in an application or a calibration where we are reporting alumina later, we need to recalculate that value to make it match with other standards. Also, most of the standards, the concentrations apply to a certain condition. In this case here, it's stated in this little footprint here. Certified value is traceable to the standard unit, and it is based on ignited material. So what does that mean? The 8.06% here applied to powder that has been calcinated. And to create a standard table, which is our basis for a calibration, we need to make sure that all these values have the same condition. So if you plan a calibration, first thing to do is do the standard table and then make sure that all of the analytes are in the same form and also the same condition. A little remark here, later on we'll be talking about these fundamental parameters a bit more. If you plan using them, make sure all of your standards are very close to 100%. Otherwise, the mathematics don't work. So that is something to keep in mind when we're starting. So how does calibration work? We start with our standard table, and then we measure, for each analyte, we measure these element line or channels so that we get an intensity, a count rate, and that later allows us to make this calibration curve where we have concentration versus intensity. And yeah, ideally we have something nice like this, but of course in the reality it's never that easy. Basis curves are not the common case, and one of the reasons for that might, for example, be that there is a spectral interference, like a line overlap. If we look at the usual spectra, it looks something like this. So we would measure at this position here, and then in this case we have a background measurement here, and we can see that there are other peaks nearby, so we want to be careful where to position our measurement angle and also the background angle. And maybe there are even some overlaps that we cannot address this way. So what we need to do is we need to do a correction for them. And we are starting with this because this is all still on the intensity side of the calibration. This is line overlap corrections are intensity based corrections. And to give you an idea how to find those, we're going to go through the whole process here and a few examples. So the first thing you would do when making a calibration is you would optimize your measurement condition, your channels. And so what you want to check is the, as I said, the peak position plus the background position. And you want to make sure that the backgrounds, of course, are positioned somewhere where there is no signal and the peak position is in the maximum. And in this case, we have an example of a very common line overlap, which is zinc on sodium. So we have a scan here with a sample that only contains sodium. And then this one would be a sample that only contains zinc. And you can see it's pretty close to another. And in the end, we end up with something like this. If we combine those two samples or those two positions here, is the blue one is what we want to measure. We want to measure sodium. But now here in the red one, we have a combination of both. And we can see that there's obviously some zinc here, and so we're on the flank of that peak, which increases our sodium sample, our sodium signal by quite a bit. And we can see by this little hump here that there's also some sodium on top. So there is an increase in sodium signal, which is based on the concentration and signal of zinc because of that overlap. And of course, we don't want that. We actually want to correct the sodium intensity here with the zinc one. We want to do a line overlap correction to get a less interfered signal for sodium. And the practical way to do that is you would need at least two samples. More is better, but two is like the minimum that we need to calculate this. And both of these samples should not contain our analyte. In the example, that would be sodium. So we need two samples and they should not have sodium. And then one of them should have the interfering element zinc and the other one should not have the interfering element zinc. So we need a 0-0 sample and a 0 sodium, a lot of zinc sample. And that way we can make a line overlap correction in terms of a simple mathematic dependency where we look at the interfering count rate or the interfering signal from zinc in this case versus the analyte intensity. And this is an example that I copied from our machine. This is actually one of the overlaps. So you can see down here would be our zero sample. It has zero sodium and zero zinc. So the intensity of our analyte sodium is zero. And there are some other samples. I unfortunately had to deselect them because the display is a bit wonky, so we just get the curve here. But in case the other samples that are used here also do not contain sodium, but they contain a lot of zinc interfered here. Like you can see the interfering KCPS rises. And that also causes the analyte intensity to rise. But of course, it's not coming from the analyte. It's the line overlap. And with those two samples as a minimum, more again are better, we can describe this this signal dependency and correct our measurement signal before we actually do concentration analysis. So what we are doing is we're taking our measured signals and we correct them for possible line overlaps. And to give you some examples here, we talked about sodium and zinc. There are some other quite common ones. You probably heard of this one here. There is the brome L-alpha overlaps on alumina K-alpha. So you can see that displayed here. They're a bit further apart, but still, if we have the alumina K alpha here, the brome overlap might overlap. And since brome is a common additive used, for example, in fusion, this always needs correcting in that case. Another additive we use in fusion is iodide. It has the same effect as bromide. And the iodide L-beta overlaps titanium K-alpha. The example here is that we have two samples here. The blue line, the flat line is, your chemical zero. There is no titanium in here and also no iodide. And you can see it's a nice flat line. And then the red line is actually the same sample, the blank, but in this case, we added some of our ammonium iodide solution. Again, it's an additive. And we immediately find titanium as a signal, but yeah, it's chemically, it's not titanium, it's iodide that overlaps here, and it's the L-beta. So again, if we're using additives with our sample, we always want to and make sure to think about what possible overlaps could result of that, could be introduced to our system as a sort of result here. Well, I hear you ask, where do I get all that information from? How do I decide what overlaps are necessarily? And fortunately, these effects are pretty much known because they are based on physics and the energy that we actually measure. So one way to actually check is to have some sort of table or tool. And as an example here, we have this periodic table you see down here where we, based on the, I think this is the energy actually, and the electron jump, based on that you can see what energies are close to another. And you can see here the K alpha of sodium is very close to the zinc L beta and L alpha, sorry. And again, alumina, bromine, again the energy is very close. The same for titanium here. And then it's iodide. I think that's up here. I can't really see it because, yeah, iodide is up here then. And the last one is to give you an idea, a very interesting, why is it not moving now? Okay, I need to click here again. Okay, so it gets interesting when you're, for example, looking at the rare earths, because as you can see, this clusters up quite severely. So looking at the rare earths, there is a lot of line overlaps that we need to watch out for, so to say. And especially since these are so heavy atoms in the order wise, there is a lot of lines to take into consideration here and to check for possible line overlaps. As a helpful tool, most of the softwares that we've been using in our lab, they contain a pretty good library of all these overlaps, and they can also help you to investigate and address and check. So there is always helps in the tables, and if you want to make a calibration and you're thinking, what kind of overlaps do I need to watch out for? The first thing, you can check it up there, and then you can always check it with scans, of course, as well. So, back to our overview. Line overlap, again, to summarize, this is a correction of spectral interferences, and we do it on the measurement signal. Basically, let's try to remember our example of sodium and zinc. Basically, what we do here is we subtract intensity from our sodium line based on the intensity of the zinc that we measure. So we modify the intensity in our elemental line to minimize interferences. And then we move on to the next step of calibration, where we now establish a curve, a description on how to transfer our intensity into concentration or measurement unit that we want to do. So that, of course, might bring other problems, and we need other corrections here. And so we'll go through the three cases that we will showcase here. And of course, the easiest way the preferable way to describe our intensity is this, a simple mathematical curve, first order. So we basically want to establish two coefficients. In this case, they are called A0 and A1. And in terms of mathematical, if we look at a calibration with no matrix correction, we are just looking at the base curve. And so our concentration, for example, let's use sodium here again, concentration of sodium would be A0 plus A1 multiplied by the intensity of the sodium channel, which has been corrected for the zinc overlap already. And that would give us a concentration analysis on sodium. So that's actually how we want it. We have a picture demonstrating in here just as a sort of explanation here. But in reality, it never works that well. And we have another example here. This would be chrome in a ferrochromium alloy. And in theory, we want something like that, our intensity versus the concentration, and we get a nice line. But in reality, we often get something bended like this. So we can see that there is sort of a curve going on here. And the explanation for this is one so-called matrix effect. In our example, it is the concentration of iron in your sample bends the curve. And as an explanation why, you've probably seen that before in some of the other presentations, but we have this explanation for the effect. The square here is our sample, and the blue arrow represents our X-ray tube, basically, or the X-rays exciting the sample. And now in the sample, we have all the atoms get excited, and they start their fluorescence thingy. And now in this system, we have chrome and iron. And what happens with the iron, it is there's two cases. Iron either does the fluorescence and it gets out of the sample or is detected. Or in another case, the iron fluorescence can cross-excite the chromium in the sample. And what that effect means then is that the iron fluorescence gets partially absorbed. The iron fluorescence gets partially absorbed by the chromium due to the secondary excitation. And so the intensity we find is lower than the theoretical one. And on the other hand, chromium gets excited by the X-ray tube and by the iron atoms in the sample. So this secondary excitation of the chromium by the iron fluorescence increases the signal of our chromium, and that is why the curve is banded. The more iron is present, the higher the curve rises. And in order to correct for that now, we need another correction model, and that is, for example, the all well-known alpha corrections or matrix corrections. So what we want to do is we want to establish a correction factor that makes sure our calibration points on the curve move back to the linear curve. And that works this way. You might remember this term. This was on the first sheet for the base curve, but now we have an additional term behind it. So what it basically says is that we correct the chromium concentration here based on our iron concentration. And of course, you can do multiple of those, but we do an adjustment of one concentration using the other, and the alpha factor here is the key to make it mathematically. I won't go into too much detail over the curve. I think that's not, I think it's a better idea to just describe the effects. And we have an example here. You can't really make it out because it's probably too small, but this is a base curve. This is an example of a base curve. You can actually see here there is zero interfering channels, and my standard deviation here is 1.29. So that is I think SEAE is standard estimated error. So what I do now is practically I'm checking here what are my systematic effects. So you can see some of the samples are on top of the curve, some below. And now I look for similarities in those sample, and based on that, I select possible interfering elements, and I can calculate an alpha factor for me. The software does it for me. It uses the formula we just had and calculates that alpha factor for me. And as a guideline, usually the main components of your actual sample are the typical suspects, I think is the name. If you're looking, for example, in an iron ore, so a lot of your sample is iron, then iron will probably have a matrix effect on many other elements. So when we are looking for the calibration of these other elements, we might want to check an alpha for iron just to see if our SEE actually gets better. And each software has a different way to accomplish this. In this case, you make a few boxes, you check here, you check down here, and then he calculates for you. And what happens is your curve changes. You can make it out on the picture here. You can see like this one spreads a lot more, and then these ones are a lot more narrow, like the points are more narrow to your curve. And also as an indication, the standard estimated error is cut roughly, it's more than double, it changes. So it's only a third now. And if you look closer here, there is actually six interfering channels that we selected here based on the matrix itself. That would be one way to make concentration-based correction called empirical corrections. There is a catch here. We can only do that if we have a large set of standards. The general rules apply here is that when you want to make a calibration, we at least, well, if it's first grade, that is, at first order, at least we need to calculate the slope and intercept. And for that, we need a number of standards to make it, yeah, reliable and proper. And now when we want to introduce empirical alpha correction, we have more coefficients to calculate. So we actually need more sample. And the general rule is that we want to have like 3 samples per coefficients, roughly. So let's say as an example, you want to make a curve with 3 interfering elements. That means we need to make 5 for the base curve, and then, well, the rule says 2 to 3, so it's either 6 or 9. So that means in order to make a proper calibration curve with 3 alpha corrections, we need 11 to 14 standard. And the more corrections you want to do, the more samples you need to provide. Again, unfortunately, most of the times standards are expensive, not available. We don't have that much samples. So the solution here is to, instead of using empirical alphas, where we calculate it from our set of standard samples, we use theoretical alphas, which are also called fundamental parameters. You probably heard that one before. And let's maybe have a look at the pictures first. Again, it's an actual example, and you can see that there is a similar effect here regarding the SEE. The big advantage of the theoretical alphas is that it is a lot easier to use in terms on how to apply this. In this example, it's the press of a button. You see, well, obviously German software here, but they are called variable alphas here. And the only thing you need to do is you click them from on to off, and they are automatically applied. A few rules to keep in mind here. In order to use this mathematical model, you need to describe your standard samples to 100%. If you sum up the concentration, they need to be at 100% or very close to it. The usual bracket in which tolerance is allowed is like 99.5 up to 100.5. And sometimes you can trick softwares by introducing a filler. For example, when talking about powders, you can just say, hey, there is a rest of oxygen, and kind of do it that way. Also, you need to describe your sample preparation, because we need to, for example, doing a fused bead, we need to tell him that there is tetraborate present and so on. Again, most softwares have kind of an automatic procedure for that. So it's just something to keep in mind. Empirical, we can calculate with very little information, but we need a lot of samples. And if we want to use fundamental, we need to describe the details of our sample. They need to be tried chemically in 100%, but they work pretty well with as a small set of standards. Or if you want to go for a more general program and general kind of calibrations. And yeah, again, easy to use, because you basically just switch them on. The mathematics for it are a lot more complex. In generally, what you have here is you calculate this mu tot, which is the sum of all influences. So that's why you also need to describe, for example, your sample prep, because they actually might affect this. And most of the softwares have a simple library for that. Some other softwares have a calculator for it, where you have to input what analytes you're analyzing and what preparation you are using, and then he will calculate for you. I think the actual calculation is quite complex, so we are happy we're living in an age where computers take over everything, and they just do it in a matter of seconds, because as harmless as this formula looks, I think it's actually a lot of calculation that happens when you do it. And yeah, this all comes down to our little overview here. Again, it's a sheet we use quite often. I don't think it makes sense to read it to you, but basically we have three models of correction. The easiest one is we take the base curve with no correction, so we only have the slope and intercept of our calibration curve. The next one would be empirical alphas, which are calculated from your actual sample set. And the last one is theoretical alphas or fundamental parameters, which are calculated in a more general way to compensate all possible effects that are in your samples. And both of them are, they have their pros and cons, of course. And again, I think you can pause it here and have a look at the little table, because we are already over our time limit. So feel free to read up on here. And that's been it, actually. We're finished with the correction models for calculation. Next topic will be the drift correction and drift correction samples and measurement. We'll check back on your question and answers in a bit, and you will get an email from us. Thank you very much for your attention, and have a nice day.